So I'm going to talk about online disk encryption. Let me just very quickly do some present some motivation. Why would anyone want to re-encrypt his drive? It's basically the first case would be a different data lifetime versus algorithm lifetime. We may want to keep a data on disk for such a long time that, well, it doesn't seem so likely today, but algorithm for encryption may become obsolete, and then we need to migrate the data to a different encryption algorithm. The second use case would be to cut off access to a data with a volume key backup, which in case of LUKS is basically just a LUKS header backup. And just let me point out that in such case, LUKS passphrase change doesn't affect volume key, so it's definitely not enough to change your passphrase because volume key stays the same. And it may be enforced by volume key change. It may be enforced some policy in organization. It may be even required to change on some regular basis, for example, like once per year, and so on. We provide the offline cryptsetup reencrypt tool in a cryptsetup suite for some time, but it turned out it lacks a few features. Well, obviously, offline utility wasn't online, but perhaps this wasn't the major issue. Much more important turned out to be the fact that even by a feedback from community, it wasn't considered to be robust enough or reliable enough so that people will start adopting. They were always afraid what happens when my system crashed during the re-encryption and so on. So let me clarify my introduction slide once more, because I think it's much more important to say that the new re-encryption will be okay online, but it will be also much more resilient. So it should be much more reliable. And what do we mean by resilient? Well, cryptsetup provides software full disk encryption. So to perform re-encryption, we need to overwrite basically whole drive. So when we perform the re-encryption, we divide the device in so-called re-encryption zones. And if crashes occur, during the time we are writing the encryption zone, we may produce torn writes. And so to be more reliable, we need a means to detect and correct these torn writes inside our encryption zone. And for that, we need additional storage to keep some metadata, and we need a metadata format flexible enough so that we can track progress of our encryption properly. And obviously, LUKS version 2 format provides both of these. So, how do we ensure that the new re-encryption tool would be much safer? We introduce a few so-called resilience modes. The first one is called the checksum-based resilience mode. And what we do? Imagine we are going to re-encrypt one of our encryption zones. So we divide this re-encryption zone in a smaller chunks, which should be basically underlying physical sector size large, and we calculate checksum per each of these sectors. We keep this information in memory, then we re-encrypt the segment in memory, calculate one more checksum for the new ciphertext. We store all the checksums in metadata area. And after that is finished, we start to write the re-encryption zone. So that's one way to provide better resilience. The second one is a classical journal. There's nothing to explain. It works exactly the same like a file system journal. We just write basically the data twice. And third type of resilience is so-called data shift. In this case, it works due to fact that it's not re-encryption in place. Imagine that we have this, we have re-encryption zone, and for first half of the zone is all ciphertext. Usually it will be plain text because we use it in online encryption. And we just read the data, encrypt, and write into second half of the encryption zone. So basically it's a data shift, and we always have an original copy of the data and space for new ciphertext. And well, this can be called a resilience mode at all, but we provide also so-called no-op resilience mode, which basically does almost nothing. It performs no data syncs, it performs no commit in metadata area, and basically the only way this mode is safe is if you are sure that reencryption finishes successfully or it's gracefully interrupted, for example, by sick term. We decided to provide this mode because it's really fast, and if you have, for example, a snapshot backup of the data, you may want to perform the reencryption faster, and in case of failure, you have a backup point in some snapshot. Okay, so what happens if we experience crash during the reencryption? In case of checksums, we read the actual content of our encryption zone, and we don't know what part of our encryption zone is finished and what part is not. And we read the encryption zone and calculate the checksums again. And then we compare every sector checksum with checksums stored in metadata in previous step. And if checksums matches, it means this sector wasn't reencrypted, so we perform the reencryption of such sector. If it matches, it means that the sector was already reencrypted, so we can move on. And in the end, we calculate the checksum of the whole reencryption zone and compare it with this one final checksum we stored before for a new ciphertext. So we are able to detect if the recovery in case of checksums was successful or something really, really nasty happened. In case of journal, it's just a replay. We just take the segment and write it once again from the backup in metadata area. In the case of data shift, it's just usual repeat. We repeat the operation because we have original copy, and we just overwrite it. If we use no op, there's nothing to do. Okay. So that was various resilience modes for reencryption in a nutshell. And now we can speak about online reencryption layer. And it's really independent layer because users may use new reencryption tool even in offline mode, and they can benefit from the resilience as we described. File systems and applications access the data through special device stack, and this device stack is controlled by the reencryption utility, so that, of course, during the time we are reencrypting the zone, we don't want to interfere with BIOS that are coming from file system. So we need to block file system from accessing these zones during the reencryption. So how does it work in a picture? So this is how usually LUKS activated LUKS device. We have a data device with ciphertext, LUKS2 header embedded in the head of the device. On top of it, there's a DMcrypt device, and on top of it, we may have mounted file system. Then we introduce a special private device mapper device, where we move the original table from the public device with mounted file system, and then we introduce one more private device, so-called DM hot zone device, which controls the access to the reencrypted zone, because the reencryption zone is the purple box below. And as you can see, any BIOS coming to old ciphertext area can go through, because there's no risk of conflicting with reencryption process. On the other hand, the reencryption zone, any IO coming from the file system must be blocked in a DM linear hot zone device until we finish the reencryption. And For each of these reencryption zone, in case we are using the checksums based resilience, we just read all ciphertext, calculate and store checksums in a LUKS2 metadata. That's first commit point. Then we start writing, overwriting the reencryption zone with new ciphertext. And after we finish successfully this operation, we perform second metadata checkpoint and move to the second zone. And this works. It works like this for a whole device. And in the end, we will have a LUKS2 header, LUKS2 device with new ciphertext and mounted file system on top of it as well. So, how does it perform? I have tested before this for the short time. I have tested two device types: pretty legacy rotational drive, 5,000 RPMs, really old drive, and then I used a pretty modern NVMe. And well, it's no secret the NVMe performs much better than the spindle drive, as you can see here on this table. There we are comparing various resilience modes and how they perform based on spare metadata space in LUKS2 header. Because if we take a first row, these 95 megabytes of reencryption zone size is based on the fact that we have almost 4 megabytes of free metadata space in LUKS2 header. So we store checksums. We are able to store so much checksums that we can reencrypt 100 megabytes. And as you can see, for a half terabyte NVMe, it performs pretty well, even if the device is under load from other processes, which was these tests, for example. And it's pretty obvious journal performed the worst of all, because basically what we are doing with journal resilience, we read the device and write the device twice. So it's no secret that it performs very very badly. And as you can see, no-op pseudo resilience mode performs the best. And data shift, the last row is basically just pretty similar to journal mode. So for NVMe, it's pretty OK, because in checksum, you are able to encrypt it under an hour. With spindle drive, it's not so good, as you can see, because basically we are generating too many seeks on the spindle drive, and it doesn't perform very well. But if you use LUKS2 detached header, basically that's when you have a LUKS header stored in other device than the data device. As you can see, the performance is pretty good. So maybe for spindle drives, it would be a preferred setup. So we are closing to demo. And just a quick summary of features. So we'll be able to re-encrypt the device with both detached headers and embedded headers in online mode. In encryption, we are able to perform also with embedded header or detached header, but there's a really small window where we need to shut down the file system, because we need to add a device mapper, virtual device mapper device underneath the file system, and this can be done for mounted file system. So we need to just add this device, and then we can perform the encryption online. For decryption, we support online or online or offline encryption, and we use detached header only for that currently. And new encryption can be interrupted, paused, resumed. You can switch between resilience mode after interruption. And as you will see in a demo, hopefully, recovery is performed in a usual crypt activate by calls, which is basically crypt setup open. So as we will see in a demo, we didn't have to patch, for example, systemd to be able to boot this boot with interrupted re-encryption. So I will move to demo. Maybe. So I don't have a terminal. That's bad. Decrease. I haven't booted it up. I need it. This is awkward because I can get to. Yeah, I need this one. And yes. So it's a regular Fedora 29 and patched. The only package I need to update was pre-release cryptsetup. For it to work, so let me join it. I will start the. I will show you device tech first. So we have a LUKS device underneath LVM with root file system, and I will start to reencrypt it. Sure. So this is just the progress of the reencryption. As you can see, if I show you device mapper tables, you can see, yes, it's a two. Basically, what you will see that there are devices with two keys, but it just doesn't fit the device. I will run some write operation, so we have some fun. Okay, it's still running. And now I do something really, really ugly. I will just kill the virtual machine. So we sort of simulated a crash during the reencryption. Fingers crossed. And it seems okay. So I will connect once again. Let's see in a journal CTL. There should be some info, yes, about FSG key. So yes, there was just some orphaned INOs for interrupted copy operation, but file system is OK and works. So how many time do we have? I think, yes. So I will thank you for your attention, and do you have any questions?
Oh, yeah. Two questions. What's the status of this in terms of delivery? It's all upstream right now in Fedora? Is this your late again?
No.
Second question. Does this help in the situation where someone has an unencrypted LUKS volume and desires to encrypt it on the fly?
Oh, yes. Should I repeat questions? So they are corrected. Okay, so the first question was if it's already upstream or available in Fedora in or in RHEL. And the second question was if it helps people to actually encrypt their device on the fly. So yes, I'll start with the second question. The online encryption, there's this slight window where we need to, if it's a mounted file system, we need to shut down the file system, introduce the device. Then we can remount the file system and start the online process encryption. So the shutdown window is like really, really slow, but it is there. We can do it fully online. And the second question is, we are going to release cryptsetup 2.1 in the coming weeks, I think like in 2 weeks. And next upstream release should contain, after this, should contain the online encryption.
There are several methods, journal, checksum, data shift. They have different properties depending upon different use case. So how the consumer is going to select?
Yes, by default we provide them with, let me scroll back. By default, we will provide them with checksums. This should be probably a default when the user doesn't choose this. Well, the journal, the problem why we introduce the journal is that there are possibilities that if your storage is not able to provide these guarantees that it is able to overwrite one sector in atomic way, there can be a cases where checksums will not work for you. And in this case, you have to use a journal. That's the only safe way. So basically, we just wanted to provide one more completely safe solution for this. But for example, on NVMEs or SSD drives, it shouldn't be a problem. So the default should be checksum. And data shift is, for example, data shift is used anytime we need to move the data. And that's, for example, during the encryption, where we need to introduce a LUKS header inside embedded device. Like in embedded mode, we need to provide a space for LUKS2 header. And in this case, we are doing data shifts so that we can store LUKS2 header.
One more question, and I guess that's going to be the last.
Yes, so new key is stored in a regular key slot. So LUKS provides usually key slots for keys, and if you, the process of reencryption is that first you generate new key, store it in a new key slot. This key slot is so-called unbound key slot, so it's basically just stored key but unusable in this moment. And then we start the process of reencryption, and we reference key slots that are used for old ciphertext data and a reference key slot that can be used for a new ciphertext area. And if I hear you correctly, you were asking that I input just one passphrase. Yes, and that's for this activation problem during the systemd, because we don't have API to provide second passphrase for a single device. So, and we don't want to users to overwrite everything just to it. So during the reencryption, it's necessary to have two key slots with a single passphrase, but you might change it. It's just passphrase.
Okay. Thank you very much.